Good evening. Welcome to the Arlington School Committee. This is January 22nd. First off, I'd like to welcome Ms. Siobhan Foley when she comes back from the AEA. First thing on our agenda tonight, I would like to welcome the Audison Middle School a cappella group, and they're going to perform for us.
Good evening. We are Audison a cappella. Thank you so much for inviting us to come and sing for you tonight. My name is Joey.
And my name is Ben. Joey and I are student leaders for this school year. The group formed in the fall of 2013 after 3 8th grade students approached Ms. Gaffney to ask about starting a student a cappella group. Since then, we have held auditions twice for interested OMS students in grades 6, 7, and 8.
We meet once a week after school as part of the Audison AMPM program. We arrange all of our own music. A typical rehearsal has us all gathered around the CD player, working as a team to create interesting harmonic and rhythmic patterns in a lieu of instrumental accompaniment.
This year, we have sung at Town Day, Arlington First Nights, as well as numerous Audison functions. We will also be taking part in a chamber concert on March 4th that benefits the Arlington Eats program.
We hope you enjoy these three selections, The Lion Sleeps Tonight, Some Nights, and For the Longest Time. Thank you again for asking us to come and sing for you.
Some nights I stay up cashing bones from wandering, so I am who I am, who I am, oh my. Some nights I wish that this all would end, cause I could use some friends for a change. Some nights I'm scared you'll forget me again.
So inspired by you, that hasn't happened for the longest time.
like to acknowledge Ms. Gaffney, the music director. I mean, just listening to them and watching your face, how proud you are.
I'm so proud. I can't
stop. I have only one request, that you autograph your first CD to us. And I mean that. I mean, you people are awesome. You really are.
Awesome.
You're going to be a tough act to follow tonight. We should have put you at the end. That way we could have had the whole town watching and waiting. Thank you so much for coming.
Great job.
At this time, I would like to invite Representative Gobley to come to the table.
Thank you.
I'm gonna sing too.
Really? Yeah, do it all in like some kind of song. That would
yes.
be fun.
Capella.
Sing a song of local aid.
That would be great.
Be in minor key.
More money. <Yeah. laughs>
What did Kiersey say? What did you? Go ahead.
It'll okay. be in a minor key.
Well said.
Well said. Well, good evening, everybody. Thank you, Chairman Hayner, and through you to the members. Chairman Hayner asked me to come by and discuss some pieces of legislation that I filed on behalf of the Massachusetts Association of School Committees for the next term of the legislative session, which begins now and lasts for the next 2 years. We're actually in the middle of getting co-sponsors, and so I know the MASC is helping me in getting other legislators sign on to the bills that I filed. I'll go right into it. One is around mandates. You know, many of us have major concerns of state mandates coming down on municipalities across our Commonwealth and not returning those mandates or following those mandates with the dollars to pay for what the state is asking. And so this calls for a moratorium on all new mandates and new testing. So if this legislation were to pass, and it would also set up a task force to look at all of the so-called mandates and how much they cost school districts, and to really understand, do we need these mandates? If we do, how do we pay for them? Because some of them, like the anti-bullying law, are very, very, very important. You would agree. But we need the resources from the state to pay for them, and it should be a partnership. So the goal of this legislation is to really create a more involved partnership between the state and 351 cities and towns, really around shared priorities. So that's one piece I filed. And another piece is really simple, is really just around the concern of the fingerprint checks that a lot of our teachers have been burdened with in terms of paying for. In my opinion, it's just, in my opinion, it's not fair, but really this just sets up really trying to ask the Board of Elementary and Secondary Education to annualize, I guess annually, so every 2 years, to look at the proposal and find ways to, my goal is to assume the cost away from those who are currently assuming it. So those are two pieces that the Glenn Kuchar, who's the executive director of MASC, asked me to file, and so I agreed, especially on the issue of moratorium on mandates and new testing. I think it's really, really important to evaluate where we are. If you don't mind, Mr. Chairman Hayner, I do want to talk about at least one more piece of legislation, because I think it's important for public education, certainly in terms of the area of mental health. And I mentioned this to Superintendent Bodie during the MLK Jr. Observance, which was a wonderful event at the town hall. It was great to see our superintendent and many of you at the event. So I have filed the bill for the past 6 years now around educational psychologists. And many of you know there is an issue or there is a law on the books called the Mental Health Parity Law. And it's a mandate that is set up. There's about six or seven occupations that are on there. It's around insurance, that insurance companies are mandated to pay for certain services that are allocated to our children and so forth. Educational psychologists are not part of the mental health parity law. And when we did the gun bill last year, I filed legislation with the gun bill. It passed the House. It failed the Senate. And then about a month ago, the Senate passed it and the House did not. So it's passed both bodies. We're just trying to get it passed at the same time. And so it would add educational psychologists to the mental health parity law. If we want to stop gun violence, and the root of gun violence is really to address mental health services or the lack of mental health services, and this really is a way to do it. Educational psychologists are really on the dance floor, if you will, when it comes to working with students around mental health issues. And so this is a piece of legislation that I'm working. I am filing it, co-filing it with Senator Eldridge in the Senate. I asked him to file it in the Senate because I would like it to pass the Senate in trying to get it on the way to Governor Baker's desk for signature. And I just wanted to address one more thing, Chairman Hayner, around the budget. I know Cindy, I believe, or Ms. Starks is chairing the budget subcommittee again, or you're currently addressing it. Maybe I should come before your committee to talk about the budget. But we had, as many of you know, I serve on the Ways and Means Committee, as does Senator Ken Donnelly, and we were both at an all-day hearing today on the FY16 consensus revenue hearings. So currently, we are $18 million below benchmarks for estimated revenue. That may sound bad, but that's really not bad, considering we have more months to go in terms of revenue projections to try to get at benchmark. So that's actually pretty good. So why are we reading in the paper that we could be anywhere from $700 million to $1 billion in the current FY15 debt? And I just wanted to address that a little bit because I think it's very, very, very important for what we're doing, certainly at the state level. And I think you may have heard some folks saying that it's not a revenue problem, it's a spending problem. And so I just want to talk about what we've been spending on, because I think it's important. During the FY15 budget debate, and what was signed by the governor, it was a balanced budget when it was signed. And the new revenue, and it was over $150 million in new revenue, that money was used solely, or 50% of it, solely on pension liability. That is an issue that is so very, very important that we need to address, and that's something that we did, and it's something that our bond agencies demand us to do when they look at our rating and they, you know, judge our new bond rating. In terms of the other issues around the shortfall, most of it is around Medicaid. Around if you remember the website last year, so it's around Medicaid and it's around DCF. We had many, many concerns around DCF caseload when we had two or three young children die. A lot of the new spending in FY15 was around that issue. We will close the budget gap because revenues are continuing to grow. You know, capital gains tax revenue is very volatile, so is sales tax revenue, but they are continuing to grow, even healthier in some areas than they have in the past. And we will use that money, and we will put that money in the rainy day fund and be able to pay for the deficit in that way. There should be no need to cut local aid or to cut other items. So I just wanted to bring that to the committee's attention. As I talk about this new legislation, we really need to talk about where we are in terms of the budget. And the consensus revenue hearing for FY16 that was held today is really an initial part. But I would say personally, you know, that we're, you know, $18 million below benchmark is obviously a concern, but it could have been far worse. And so, you know, through you, Mr. Chairman, I can work with the budget subcommittee to come before a hearing and to talk about, you know, what's going on statewide.
That'd be wonderful. Thank you. Does anybody have any questions? Mr. Schlickman.
First of all, I want to congratulate Mr. Garbley on his new term and that excellent picture I saw of him chumming around with his old buddies, Mitt Romney and Bill Weld. That was quite amazing. You know, we had an issue before us a couple of weeks ago, and I know that I forwarded it to you, and that we requested the committee to work with you to come to a resolution. And I know we've been having issues with the bus service getting our kids to school in the morning. This has been a recurring problem. Do you have any history to tell us, or what your thoughts are on this?
Sure. Well, to address both points, one you mentioned the inauguration of of our governor, mm-hmm. Charlie Baker, and there were other members of the Republican Party there, and I will welcome anybody to the State House, whoever would like to come and visit, including you, Paul, if you would ever like to come and visit us at the State House. I'll bring you onto the floor and take pictures with you any day of the week. So I appreciate you bringing that up as well, and I do appreciate your congratulations. In terms of the bus service, this has been a concern for the past 5 years. I remember getting calls about it from Kiersey and other folks on the committee. And Paul, you correctly stated you had contacted me a couple of weeks ago. Every time I get a phone call, I call the Department of Transportation. And I've talked to the past when it was Secretary Davey. I know Senator Donnelly would do the same thing and has done the same thing. And, you know, it's an approach of, you know, getting more buses out there. And the concern we've talked about is the issue is when do buses do come, they're bunched up, you know, they're not running on schedule, and especially during the morning hours, it's inexcusable to have 20, 30 kids standing there and buses just drive by without picking them up. So, you know, I've made a request to the new secretary of the Department of Transportation that we really need a short-term and a long-term fix. In regards to buses, that it's absolutely unacceptable, and so we'll continue to work on it. I think one thing I did mention to you, Paul, is the idea of having the general manager of the T, and I've offered this to her in the past, or have asked her to come ride the buses in Arlington with me, but to have her join me possibly at a school committee meeting, and to hear directly from school committee members about those concerns. You know, the T is funded a number of different ways, but one of those ways is by sales tax and local assessments that are assessed on communities. And there's 175 cities and towns within the MBTA region. Mm-hmm. Arlington actually happens to be one of the heavily assessed communities. We pay north of $2 million each year. And I think it's inexcusable to have some of the lack in MBTA service that we have, especially when it comes to kids having to wait for buses. I think it's a safety issue. You know, in terms of what I've done in the past, you know, I've called the Department of Transportation and the MBTA, and the problem was fixed, you know, for a number of times. It's, you know, you call, it's fixed for 3 months, but then we go back to the problem. You call, it's fixed for two more months, and then you have to, then the problem exists again. So we have to keep working on it.
My sense is this is just beyond the schools. This is a systemic problem with regards to the quality of the bus service, particularly on the 77 line. And I'm sure that if you were able to get the general manager out here to town hall, we could probably pack the place with people who want to discuss the transportation service in the town of Arlington.
Absolutely.
I mean, one day last fall, I just happened to be watching the buses on Mass Ave as I was doing my daily errands on a Saturday morning. And every time I turned around, there were two buses
bunched up together
on a Saturday without traffic. And when we came home from Thanksgiving, we were at Harvard waiting for a bus to come out at 7 o'clock at night on a Sunday. What traffic?
Yep.
And of course they were bunched, and there was a long wait for a crowded bus and another bus following us empty. And and so if that head weighs 15 minutes apiece, you had people on the streets are waiting a half an hour for a bus on a Sunday night when there's really no traffic out there. I think there's a quality control issue we need to address that affects our kids and affects every resident who rides the bus.
It's a customer service issue. I Definitely agree.
This is important, but we need to keep it right on school issues.
Yeah, just a couple quick questions. Thank you, Representative Garley, for being here tonight. The Mass Teachers Association, for their legislative package for this year, has listed a couple of items that I found to be interesting, one of which is the moratorium on high-stakes testing in PARC.
Mm-hmm.
And they, in that act relative to that, they're looking for a three-year moratorium on the use of PARC, as well as a three-year moratorium on the use of standardized testing to determine things like high school graduation, evaluation of teachers, and assessing performance of schools and districts. Where do you stand, and where do you think the legislature might stand, your colleagues, on that particular bill?
Well, you know, I, when a bill's filed, it's a conversation, right? That's really all it is a conversation that will be had during, you know, the committee process of education, when it's heard. You know, I've always been concerned with high-stakes testing. You know, I've always refused the idea that the MCAS or PARC is the best way to evaluate 12 years, even more, 13 years, if you will, in a student's life in the Arlington Public Schools. There needs to be a better way to evaluate. Some kids aren't good at taking tests, and I think to have it all come down to a single test is unfair. As you may know, I graduated the first class ever that had to pass a standardized test in order to graduate high school. And that put on tremendous pressure for the teachers who had to prepare students. And you know, it's always concerned, right? Are we as a state getting better at taking tests or training our teachers how to teach better to take tests? Or are we learning better? Are we teaching better? And I think that's a difficult question to answer. And that's why I think a bill like that is very important to file, because we need to find out. I'm not sure who filed that bill, but I will certainly look at it. I have supported legislation in the past to look at a whole different wide array of diagnostic evaluations when you evaluate a student, not just the high stakes test, but other possible ways of evaluating students where other types of students may be able to flourish. But
thank you. Before I let you go, I would ask you to keep us informed of whenever this hearing's on the bills you file for us and any other educational bills. Just
great.
let Karen know, and she'll pass it on to us.
Great.
And you'll have our support.
Thank you so much for coming out.
Thanks
a lot. Have a great night.
At this time, we have public participation. I don't think we have any, so we'll move on. I will invite our athletic director, Ms. Dugalecki, to come forward. I apologize for the mispronunciation.
No problem, Dugalecki. It's not an easy one.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you all for having me and providing me the opportunity to give you an update on the athletic department and the different things going on within our programs. On average, we service about 350 athletes for about 15 to 20 hours a week, so it's a substantial amount of time that we're spending with them. And our focus in the last year and a half has really been to make it an educational athletics program that focuses beyond the playing field, beyond sport-specific skills, and beyond the wins and losses. There was a report that came out, actually. It was very interesting. It stated that 95% of the Fortune 500 executives were high school athletes. And at the same time, less than 8% play at the collegiate level. So I share this information with the student athletes at the beginning of the year to drive home the point that, you know, if less than 8% of you are going to be playing your sport beyond high school, but then 95% of these very successful executives were high school athletes, there's something bigger than just your records that you're going to get out of your time here at Arlington High School. So that's our focus at the beginning of the year, and we have different programs in place to really drive that home for the athletes. And our main priority is to translate what they learn, whether it's overcoming adversity, resiliency, communication, advocacy, teamwork, to translate all of those, whether it's through victory or through defeat, through a difficult practice, through a day that maybe was easier than they expected it to be, or our common theme that we often talk about is athletes adjust. We talk about how you never know a bus is going to be late, you have to adjust. The weather is unpredictable, you're going to have to adjust better than your opponents. So all these different themes we kind of weave together in different programs that we have in the athletic department. And I provided some handouts for you to look at. The first page just has the homepage of our athletics website, which is copied right on there, which just talks about our mission, the core values, which mirror the eye care values of the Arlington Public Schools, and our philosophy, which echoes the life experiences, and then some of the developments that we've put into place over the last year and a half. And some of the highlights from my end have been the Coaches Advisory, which is a group of coaches at any level. They have volunteered their time to meet monthly, mm-hmm. where we assess different practices. They talk about best practices, what works, and what we can do to improve the department. Captain's Council, which meets weekly before school, and the students come in and we address different issues in the athletic department and really talk about what it means to be a leader. I think leadership is often, it's forgotten that it's a skill. It's not just being the most popular person on the team. It's not being the best player on the team. It's actually a skill that has to be evaluated and developed, and teaching them that there are different leadership styles and that they need to embrace and understand their own leadership style to be successful with it. We focus a lot on goal setting in that realm as well. Another highlight has been using athletics as a means to build spirit, and that's in partnership with the school, the different groups within the school. Specifically, we've worked a lot with the student council. We've implemented Spirit Week and Pep Rally with them. Also working with different programs within the town. Tomorrow, we've partnered with the youth outreach program to have a special event at our basketball games. We do a lot with we had the Cub Scouts in a couple of weeks ago. Last night, we had a fourth grade team playing at the halftime of our basketball game. We've done a lot with the middle school program, so really kind of reaching out to the community through our athletic programs. And then another highlight has been implementing a handbook and evaluations and just really standardizing and making clear our expectations. And the evaluations, we have a few different ones in our department. There's a coach's evaluation, which I complete. There's a captain's evaluation, where the captains complete that, and it's feedback on their coaches as well as the department and captain's council. And then there's an evaluation available to all athletes to complete at the end of the season, which talks about their experience in the athletic department as well. So we're constantly collecting feedback and really evaluating what works well and where we can continue to improve. And Karen, I didn't know, is the website, are we able to pull that up? Yeah, sure, if possible. Real quickly, before you know, open up for questions, I'd like to show you the website, which has a lot of our information accessible on it.
Karen, you're going to need to turn the mic to her. Please.
See? Well, maybe we'll turn. Yeah, Karen's gonna turn the lights.
One more.
Too much.
Does that work?
Can you get
the other set?
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
better.
That's
better.
Good. Thank you.
So, if you're on the district homepage and you click on the high school, from here you can click on the athletics link. And we've redesigned the athletics website. As you can see, this is the page that you received a copy of. It has our contact information. Mm-hmm. Here we seasonally work with a vendor where you can buy gear. They open the store for about 3 weeks at a time. Field locations has our field locations throughout Arlington and throughout the league. The policies page has a link to our handbook, as well as the MIA handbook and the concussion course that's required. Coaches lists all of the varsity coaches by season and their contact information. The schedules are available on the schedule page. You can see today was a quiet day. Offerings has the different sports that we offer, and if teams have their own specific website, they're linked. So if I click on cross country, it'll take me to their individual website.
Is that website, do we control that website?
We monitor it, and it's under the guise and the expectations of being compliant with Arlington High School, you know, policies. It's really, all the websites are used to share information for practices, dinners, and those types of things.
But as you said, we monitor it and it has to comply with our...
Yes.
Thank you.
It does. This is a little bit of the Arlington history. Coach Ed Burns, who I've learned is quite the legend here. And then the first page here is the news and info, which is a neat page where you can get a nice snapshot of what's going on in the department. This was Coach Missouri with the Cub Scouts in the locker room. This was last night, fourth grade team playing basketball at halftime. We had some captains down at the middle school during lunch. Events going on. This is an article linking to our All Scholastic athletes' name, different articles in the Globe, trainings. This is one of our athletes right now, Miles Robinson. He was featured in the Globe for the number of slam dunks he's achieved so far this year. So if you click on here, you'll see that's a goal setting training at the MIAA. This is what Captain's Council looks like when the kids are working on Tuesday mornings. So it's just a nice place for people to access information and see what's going on within the department. And the last place that they can receive that information is through Twitter, which is mostly just score updates. But that's linked to here as well, right on the top of the page.
Any members have any questions? I have a couple, and
sure.
I read with a great interest the evaluation you do on the coaches. That's a new practice in our
yes.
town. And how's that working out?
It's going really well. It's an evaluation that takes into account the different, you know, benchmarks that we look at. So it'll have communication and organization as certain areas that are evaluated, as well as sportsmanship and having organized, challenging practices. So there are a bunch of different areas with a rubric, an area for comments, and then with each coach at the end of the season, we either come up with an improvement plan or set a goal that they would like.
So there's a rubric that says what exemplary?
Yes.
So that's not on this, but that you have a rubric when you do the evaluation.
Correct. So at the conclusion of the evaluation, there are three different standards where they would rank, and then within that determines the next step.
And the athletes get to come and their coaches as well. I saw that in the
They do, yep. All of the feedback from the athletes is incorporated into the evaluation. And the captain's evaluation is pretty thorough on the department as well as their coaches.
Good. Thank you.
Yep.
I was looking at I assume that page that has the monetary, those are the fees that we charge?
Yes.
Gymnastics is second highest.
Correct.
It's higher than football.
Yes.
Why? And I don't know whether that belongs to you or to...
Yeah. Believe it or not, and, you know, Diane can speak to this probably with more detail, but my understanding, Diane, you can correct me if I'm wrong, is when they reestablished the fees a few years back, they actually sat down and broke out the cost of every sport and did the fee, so it's proportional to that. No fee for any of our sports covers the entire...
That. I mean...
Gymnastics actually is...
Is more expensive than football.
The equipment, the ratio of coaches to players required for safety, we have about 10 players, we have two coaches, and that's required for safety and transportation. Yeah, really, I was surprised as well.
It just struck me that I know how expensive football is.
Right.
To find out that, and I know hockey is even more expensive,
right.
But.
Yeah.
Bill, did you want to try out for gymnastics?
I know it's not supposed to be a contact sport. That I do know, and that made me a little bit nervous. As far as the fundraising, the non-booster money that's raised and stuff,
yeah.
Does that come into the general fund? And it doesn't.
You mean for the teams that have their boosters?
No. Boosters, I understand. They're a private entity. They're separate.
Right.
But I thought there was two different ways of raising money.
A thing that could be a little awkward about how you're phrasing that is that the general fund, as the town knows it, is our appropriation from town meeting. The general fund, as the high school refers to it, is their checking account, and this creates no end of confusion. Mm-hmm. Students who raise money for an event, say they throw a car wash or something, right, that money would go into the high school checking account for their use, for their own benefit. And it gets confusing because of the term general fund. It's not the general fund. The general fund is the town appropriation.
And I'll stand corrected, but my understanding, any money raised by the school department, any money, well, this is being raised by the school department.
It's being raised by students for students. It doesn't pass through the school department. It falls under the student activities account exemption of the law.
Then let me ask this. How much accountability do we have with this money? I'm not suggesting anyone is cheating or
scanning
with money.
No, it's very clear.
Do you see the amount of money?
I don't disperse the funds, but my office reviews the disbursements and the comptroller reviews them before more funds are put back into the high school checking account. And we're having an audit this June.
Okay.
And it has been audited since I've been here, so.
And I would like to commend you with the statement that something has to go out, because there's been a concern in the past. I think it's gone for the most part, where we've had people standing outside the stores basically with cans. And the statement that you have there in the handbook about fundraising is very clear, and I commend you on that. Thank you. Mr. Pierce.
Quick question, I just remembered it. Are we properly inflating our footballs, first of all?
Yeah.
Are we doing that?
My goodness, the amount of hours that has taken. Yes, we are. We don't want any distractions.
Okay, great. And a follow-up, the field is beyond its useful life. What are the plans for the athletic department to, Ms. Johnson?
It's in the capital budget.
Oh, great.
For replacement this July 1.
Wonderful. And last.
If it passes town meeting.
Okay, thank you. Last but not least, the crew is a club. It's not an athletic.
Correct.
What are the plans or thoughts about maybe making it, because a lot of students are part, no?
Who wants it?
Who wants it? I'm curious. I don't know why it's just a club.
So I actually met with the advisor, I guess, of the crew team when I first came here to kind of understand their role. And the way that they function right now, they prefer to run as a club. They're not under the guise of the MIAA. They don't have to adhere to all the MIAA policies.
Mm-hmm.
It would be challenging for them to have a co-op, which is Arlington and Belmont combined, with mm-hmm. the numbers that they have.
Mm-hmm.
So essentially, they can't run the way that they're running now as a sanctioned team.
Oh, okay.
So when I met with the coach, that was the way that they wanted to continue to run.
Great, thank you.
Yeah.
Are they completely independent from the athletic program?
They are, yes.
So no liability on our part?
Nope.
Thank you.
We occasionally store their boats.
I don't want to know that.
Mm. We haven't.
No, we do want to know.
Well,
we want to support them.
That's been history.
I don't want to know.
That is history. That's not the case now.
One last question. The field, safety from going forward.
Yes, the turf field. Yes, Diane, it's confirmed, you said, for July 1?
Yeah, we're replacing it.
Okay, I understand that, but I mean, what I understood that it had reached its max, and we will be using the field before July 1, won't we?
It hadn't reached the point where it was deemed no longer safe. We had that review and shared the results because we were getting there and we needed to plan.
Fine.
But yes, it is in compliance at this time.
And let me just ask one more. Are we going to buy the machine this time to get the full warranty? I hope. Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
At this time, I would like to invite Dr. Janga and Mr. McCarthy to come forward.
I got used to the dark.
Thank you for having us. We appreciate the chance. So we are bringing forward today the program of studies for 2015-2016. There are a couple sort of overview things I want to say before we go through the nuts and bolts, and then I know you've all had a chance to look at it, so hopefully we can. There's things that people want to focus on, and we can just answer questions. First, just FYI, there are four items. Two that are in there right now in the version that we sent that we would like to omit for now because we want to work a little bit more carefully on the language. We want to get this in the hands of the students quickly. And so even though there's lots of little things that often people need to have lots of conversations about, We really wanted to bring this forward to you, and so we put those in there, and we looked at them and said, you know, we really want to make sure the two items that are in there, one is a line about being a full-time student. The reason for that is we want to make clear to students that as part of the state requirements for 990 hours of instruction, they need to enroll for 7 classes, freshman, sophomore, and junior year, and for at least 6 classes with, if they have senior privilege, senior year, unless there's some sort of an IEP arrangement. So the principle is something we want to do, but you know how language can get slippery on these sorts of things, and we wanted to make sure that we stopped and went through sort of making sure that there wasn't some special ed term of art in the way we put that in there. So for now, we'd like to take that out. We'll bring it back to you in a month when we've had a chance to look at that. And the second language, for similar reasons, has to do with the inflation of footballs. Has to do with the NCAA, which is, we know that our curriculum B classes often are not considered for NCAA eligibility in your first year. We want to make sure that families know that as they're making the decision. However, again, we want to make sure that the way we phrase this in here does not create, we don't want to say to the NCAA, we don't think you should consider these, because that is a curricular choice on our part, and we don't want to say what the NCAA is going to decide, because we don't know. We just want to phrase it in such a way that people know that NCAA, if they're worried about NCAA consideration, which is probably 5 students, right, in the last 10 years, that's something they need to consider. And so we sort of put that in there as we were going forward and looking at it. We said we really need to make sure either that language is clear, or maybe we can solve that in another way, which is just to make it clear through guidance. So that's the second. And then the last two are two things that we've been working on, piloting backwards and are going forward on. One is the use of MOOCs through Coursera, and we are going forward with that. We didn't get you that language in time. Coursera is a provider of massive online open courses, and what we have been doing piloting this year is allowing students or teachers the opportunity to propose taking one of those outside school time for credit that it will appear on their transcript. And so we have that language, but we wanted to get it to you and let you all look at it. And then the second is the internships. We just had our internship presentation this week. And again, we were trying to get that language right as we went forward, and we would like to just refine that. So we didn't put it in there yet, but we'll get that to you in the next month. We just wanted to get the rest of it into everybody's hands beforehand. So those 4 things will come to you. The other changes you see in here sort of take 2 characteristics, I think. One is really about clarifying and refining expectations. They don't necessarily reflect changes in the way we're doing business, but they reflect an effort to make it clearer to everybody so people understand what's going forward. And then the other, I think, if you look at a lot of the requirements, based on student enrollment, student interest, you'll see an expansion in our AP and college level requirements. And then also some effort to make our schedule more flexible for some of our electives, in particular by splitting them half. And some of the ways in which they're being made flexible aren't in the program of studies because they don't need to be, in terms of if we know after we've had the enrollment, we may be able to combine or sort classes. But splitting classes in half and allowing them to co-enroll is one of the things that we've been doing. So with that, I guess I'll point to one other thing which I thought might be something that people would be interested in, and that has to do with the honor speaker language. I know that's language that people take an interest in, and so since we didn't give you the old language to compare, you know there's a change, but you don't know what used to be there. I wanted to clarify. What used to be there was not very different from what is there now. The principal appoints the honor speakers. In the old language, the criteria upon which the principal appointed was listed as included school spirit and GPA. And since we are technically not doing class rank and don't want to emphasize that as the way in which we assess student scholarship, the language was changed more generally to student scholarship. And the way I've done that last year, and we'll do that again this year, is we do look at kids' GPAs, but we also get feedback from the staff in terms of how they function in terms of scholarship. And then the other language was school spirit, which I changed to school citizenship, because I think that more broadly reflects our values as a school, as opposed to what I think school spirit means to many kids, which is, you know, rah-rah, and were you on the football team? And that's, I think, not really what we're trying to get at. So that was the change there. Is there anything that you want to hit on before we?
No, I think you covered a lot of it.
Can I just say one thing before I let him talk? This is a huge job, and Bill has taken absolutely the point in doing this. And if I don't give him credit every time I say just about anything about class scheduling and the program of studies and all those things about the smooth running of the school, it's only because I'm so used to having him sitting right here making me look good that I forget. So I just wanted to say that before you say anything.
I was just going to say we're very excited at the number of courses that we're going to be able to expand on next year, assuming it gets approved. We're offering two new AP courses, two new science extracurriculars that look, electives, mm-hmm. look very interesting. So, you know, we're just very happy that the staff are very excited about next year, and they're looking to expand, and they're expanding in the right way.
Thank you.
Questions?
Thank you very much. Question about how the staff can give their input into the handbook. How do you meet regularly about it during the year? Can you just describe for us the input that you all get from the staff?
So we started this process pretty much in September for this year. We said, look, we want to get this out as quickly as possible. We talked first in the program, we talked to the department heads, and the department heads go back to the staff and talk to them about what courses they currently are offering, what courses they want to offer. In the individual courses, almost all of these, if there's a course that a teacher teaches, like CAD, I've sat down with Ken Bies-Vatan. Matt Coleman has sat down with Ken Bies. The same thing with the new music courses that are being offered. Mm-hmm. We sat down with Pat Tassoni and John D. Tommaso. Mm-hmm. The new science classes came, you know, Josh Roth proposed them, and then they discussed them within the department in terms of, because part of the issue also is not just who offers the five, I can't remember what it's called, but I call it the five experiments that changes the world, but if he's going to be offering that, what does that mean about what other people will be offering? So as they discuss that, other student people were interested in offering the archaeology or covering other things. Mm-hmm. So it really is sort of a departmental discussion, mm-hmm. especially because often the new classes are ones people are really excited about teaching, and you don't want it to be that the guys who do those things that are really excited are doing it, and then everybody else is getting stuck with the stuff no one wants to teach. It really is a departmental discussion.
Thank you.
I'm wondering how many of the new courses are needed because we're increasing the number of students that we have to have offerings for, or whether we're trying to expand our offerings.
So the number of students isn't really increased in the last couple of years, but as we've talked about before, we are really trying to offer more electives to fill places where we've seen these holes in kids' schedules. And so the half-year courses, for example, allow a student to, if they're taking public speaking, to be able to take a course opposite that. The mixed chorus is being offered actually opposite PE for freshmen and sophomores, so that students who are coming in freshman and sophomore year and want to be in the chorus still have the opportunity to take another elective if they don't feel like they need a study hall. So the space in our schedule and the student schedule that sort of demands and also allows for these has to do with our efforts to make better use of time and to give kids more options.
Okay.
That's
exactly my question, because there's been concern that if we expand our offerings too much, that we're setting up the number of teachers that we can't continue sustainably. But if we're having to do it because otherwise there isn't a teacher in front of a student, then I think that's a fairly good argument to have something new.
Yeah, I mean, one, yes, we are absolutely trying to do it because otherwise there isn't a student in front of the teacher. And two, we are part of the conversation about what we could offer is limited by the number of teachers we have available to teach them. And there's a little bit of over-offering, probably, based because we don't know which of these will fly. So if, you know, we get a lot of interest in the two science electives, than some of our additional, and can I say this about educatious money? So
I don't know what you want to say, but
no. One of the things that Dr. Bodie and I have discussed is that we have brought in a number of new international students, mm-hmm. and so we're using the international student money to have an extra one FTE, and so that allows, and frankly, those students then often are taking a lot of those electives, mm-hmm. so that allows us to have a little bit to work with in terms of, okay, we can put 0.2 of that towards an extra art teacher, or 0.2 of that towards an extra science teacher for an extra section. And part of the conversation then also when I went to mm-hmm. Larry, for example, about science is, can you find a 0.2 art teacher? I mean, science teacher or a 0.2 art teacher if we only need to do one section? Because we don't want to offer a class that then we don't have a fractional person to do. Mm-hmm. And so in all of these cases, we know we can find the staffing. We believe we can find the staffing, and we also have the funding to do it. Mm-hmm. But all of them then are also dependent on school budget's got to pass, mm-hmm. and how many FTE we can get.
Thank you.
I move acceptance of the amended program of studies for Arlington High School.
Second.
You want to say anything beyond that?
I think it's great, you guys, and I think the fact that you can add so many different courses to help students is a great thing, so thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to begin by thanking you for all the work. I was involved in scheduling just an elementary school once, and I volunteered once, and never to do it again. I cannot imagine what you go through on this. One quick question. Several weeks ago, you came before us asking for more staff. I heard you just mentioned about using the international money for an additional one. How important, I mean,
so what was the question? How important are the new staff?
Yeah.
So, I mean, so there are two levels, right? You know, we believe the first staff that we requested was the dean, and we really think that that's going to be important for supporting a lot of our at-risk students and being able to keep on serving the larger group of kids that are struggling in many different ways. The 0.4 science teacher, those are what I call the hard targets. That's something we really need. If we don't get that, then a lot of these electives don't become an option for us. Beyond that, we are still squeezed. We are squeezed in terms of we have many, many students who were turned away from taking culinary last year. We have very large still class sizes in English and math. Our art classes, most of our electives, frankly, are pop busting at the seams. When I had that conversation with Kathy about, you know, can we get that 1.0, I was hoping very much that that wasn't, I got Peter and then I lost Paul. You know, I really do feel like we need, and we're trying, you know, in order to get up to the ratio that I think the high school should have to be at parity with the rest of the district and to be closer to state averages, we would need more than what we asked for. But I think if we don't get the basic ask, we'll have a really hard time. Can I just say one more thing on that?
Go right ahead.
The other thing is that when we were looking across 5 years, for us, part of the issue was over the next 4 or 5 years, we are going to need a math teacher, an English teacher, a social studies teacher. And so if we don't get 1.0 FTE this year, we're going to be coming back next year and asking you for 5 as opposed to asking you for 2 or 3. So it's not, you know, it's not a savings right away.
I think every one of us knows that this district is growing.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Is any further discussion on the motion that's before? As amended, do you feel that we will have to vote on the addendum that they will bring forward at a later date?
I don't. I think the idea is just to give you a copy of it electronically. In fact, it'll be on the website. It's just that they want to be able to get this out to students and begin the scheduling process, it takes a while. And one thing that Matthew was talking about, it's important to understand too, is that this is a student-driven process, because while we offer the electives, they may not sign up. And we have sort of baseline numbers. We're not going to run electives with 5 students. They have to have a certain fill in order to do that. And then you wait and see, is this year the year we have 4 sections of geometry, or do we have 3 sections of geometry? It depends on the selections and where kids are.
Yeah.
So that's why it takes a while, and guidance counselors want to meet with students to help them make the decisions, because they do need a lot of guidance on this.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposition? Unanimous vote. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Very much.
Thank you.
Thank
Good
you.
Job.
At this time, we will have the second reading of the 2015-2016 calendar. Dr. Bode?
The second read is the calendar. You had two options last time, but really only one option is an option that we can vote on, which is in alignment with the contract we have with our teachers. And in that contract, which by the way had been altered in the last negotiations, has students still coming to school after Labor Day, the first Tuesday after Labor Day, and the calendar that was presented to you last meeting has the Tuesday after Labor Day. Teachers attend two teacher days the previous week on Wednesday and Thursday. Now, when we look at the calendar going out, the school committee is obliged to also schedule 5 snow days. And what that does when we start after Labor Day is that we're going to be going to the, we have to schedule to the 29th. So parents need to know that we could potentially be in school the last week of June next year. Teachers need to know that they can't plan vacations or other teaching positions or jobs until we get through that. I think certainly we will have a much better idea as we get closer to late spring as to where we stand. But this particular calendar does pose the risk that if we have a very snowy winter and we exceed those number of days, in fact, we have one extra day. We can go to June 30th. But after that, we must have 180 days, and that will mean that we will have to look at either Saturdays or April vacation. But I can't determine right now what that might be. So that's where it is. That's the calendar. Now, calendar just simply gives the vacations, the start date, the snow days, the professional day. We still will bring you a more expanded calendar, as we did last year with the early release days and conference days, but there's still some work that's being done on that.
Mm-hmm. I just noticed that the school committee will be finished the regular year before if we have a lot of snow, before the school finishes. You need a motion.
I need a motion to approve this calendar as presented.
I'll entertain a motion to approve the calendar presented by the superintendent. We'll discuss it in a second.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion.
I'm just a little confused about the process.
Go right ahead.
Questions. So is this a preliminary approval or is this a final approval? And that's what I'm.
This gives us the starting date, potential end date, with or without
this.
Snow days.
Okay, so
and holidays for now.
So regardless what happens with negotiations, this would be approved. Okay,
yes.
That's what I
want
to know. Okay.
Well said, Mr. Pierce.
On the graduation being Saturday, June 4th, what was the? I guess the Saturday was the first time we did it on a Saturday for some time, last year, this year.
Mm-hmm.
This past school year. Any thought about putting it back on Sunday, keeping it on Saturday was desirable? Why? What was the process in coming to that decision?
That's a very good question. The process for the Saturday came from multiple sources at the time. Parents felt that there was a couple of reasons. One, a number of parents said that it would be better on a Saturday because when people come in for graduation, it gives them an opportunity to have a dinner or family event before they have to go back on Sunday. Whereas when graduation's on Sunday, often people have to leave right after graduation. Mm-hmm. Another issue was we have a tradition of the last blast, which happens after graduation. The seniors come back for an all-night party. And our chaperones include administrators, teachers, and parents. And
come to school the next day.
Well, they don't. That's the problem. And they're just exhausted. So by moving it back, they have the Sunday to,
to sort of recover recuperate before the week starts. So those were the two major reasons why that was changed. Now, I have had some discussion, and I'm not quite sure where this is. Mm-hmm. The administration approached me about what about should we have it in the afternoon or the morning of Saturday? Mm. There's and I think they're going to go through some kind of a survey process to to think further about it. The afternoon presents the issue of heat and being on the so. Mm-hmm. By moving it back into the morning, it would be a cooler time. Mm-hmm. You know, there's still sometimes sports going on with club sports. There's no perfect time to have graduation, but I don't think that there was any thought this year of going back to Sunday. Now, should that... I don't think there's any plans for that to change. I think the only plan is the time of the day. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean that in future years we can't go back to a Sunday if after people experience this, that this is not the desired day.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay, while I'm thinking of it, the early release elementary conference, 11:15, any thought about making that time a little later, say 12?
Well, it's something we can certainly look at. What we have to do is this. Elementary conferences are 20 minutes. And we need to be able to have scheduled. It doesn't mean that there's not flexibility. In fact, we've been talking with the union about some flexibility when elementary teachers may want to be scheduling in the mornings, for example. But in terms of being on the books, in terms of having time for all of the conferences. So if you have a class of, what we were figuring out last year was 26, we needed to be able to have that many slots available.
So in essence, there are two 11:15s for elementary parents, right? There's an all district 11:15, and then there's one specific for elementary. So there's two 11:15s for elementary parents.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
and that's not new. I mean, we've had
We've done that. Yes.
Just wondering if one of those could be pushed a little
later.
If the slots are.
Well, we haven't, this calendar here, this is just to give you an idea.
Yeah.
We still haven't determined early release days.
Right.
And that will be in the next iteration of the calendar you will approve. And that is something I can bring back. But again, we're going to have an evening conference for elementary.
Mm-hmm.
And we just have to make sure we have enough 20-minute slots.
I just want to reiterate, the calendar we're approving, the essence of this is the starting day, mm-hmm. the ending day with a potential 5 days snow days in it, mm-hmm. and the holidays. The fine granular meat will be brought forth as soon as possible.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And there are other issues that we need to clarify before we get that, mm-hmm. that fine part. So at this time, if there are no further questions, I'll entertain all those in favor.
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Unanimous vote again. Thank you very much. Okay, and right now we are on to the financial report. This.
Yes, as you see from the documents, we are continuing to track. Actually, our deficit has improved a little bit as we're fine-tuning projections, and I'm starting to fold into my projections things like people on leave, and you'll notice that the teacher overage has dropped if you look at the tracking report, but the sub overage has increased. That you're just starting to see some shakeout. I'm starting to project some savings in some lines where I feel very confident of it. There are other lines where I think there's still the potential for savings, but I think it's too soon to really bite for it. And so far, no snow to speak of, so that stands well, but I'm not going to count that chicken before it hatches, so.
It's only gonna snow on weekends.
Hmm.
Well, that's more expensive for me and sometimes.
Yeah. Still gotta clear it.
Yeah, snow days are actually cheaper.
Right.
Questions? Mr. Pierce.
Are the teacher overages because we budgeted and then we had to
add positions,
add more teachers? I mean, it's essentially.
But there's
that.
You know, I'm tightening it up now because there's been some turnover. People have left. People have come. You know, I'm able to refine it as I have more data points.
Okay.
tracking report. Computer supplies.
What number is that?
I'm sorry, it's 85802, down at the bottom of the tracking.
So,
we budgeted 15 and it looks...
Right. Well, that's one of those things that's budgeted in lots of different places. And the principals have a budget that it's generally budgeted in, you know, professional and technical services, supply, paper, you know, paper, instructional materials, textbooks. If they wanted to buy computer supplies, I would code the expense to computer supplies. It would still be in their budget, but there would be a corresponding savings in some of the other lines that are budgeted.
So there's no concern that...
No.
Okay. And we would not be looking to double that budget item next year?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
Furniture works the same way. If a principal chooses to take furniture out of their budget, furniture wouldn't be a line item I would budget routinely, but they're free to do so. Yes. And it would show up as furniture being over budget.
Is that
but
similar?
Then we'll show savings later in the year for the offset, because they won't go above their total.
Mm.
It's just the lines will shift.
And is that similar with the computer equipment hardware, the last line?
Yep.
Okay, and the other one, training education, yeah, sorry, 87202,
mm-hmm.
training education conference and attendance.
Mm-hmm.
Are we sending a lot of people to more conferences that we anticipate?
We are doing more professional training, but if you'll notice there is, I'm still estimating in professional affiliations and membership a pretty high number, but I think it's really unlikely that we're gonna spend $74,000 in memberships. So those two codes can be somewhat interchangeable. If a conference is part of your membership package, as my professional association does,
right.
it would show up under professional affiliations and memberships. If it doesn't, it would show up in professional development. So those two lines are kind of fudgy.
I understand that some things don't happen until different times of the year, but
mm-hmm.
shouldn't we know how many memberships we're going to be paying for? Shouldn't we also know how many conferences we're going?
But it can be, for example, I attend multiple one-day workshops throughout the year. My organization allows me to do it as part of my membership, so I pay for all of them up front.
Okay.
So I book the whole thing to memberships because it is membership, but it's also PD. You can also do it the other way. And so I think what's happened is that I have tended to budget more in the professional affiliations, when in fact now we're not doing so many bundled things, but we're doing more standalone things. If you look at the two together in terms of, you know, I'm still projecting that we're going to fully expend professional affiliations and memberships, which is unlikely at this point. I think those two lines are going to offset each other just fine.
Okay. I'm just concerned because, I mean, I hear about the added teachers that we need, that
mm-hmm.
it happens, but some of the other, that makes me nervous.
Well,
go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, you know, at this point in the fiscal year, a variance of this size is not big thing to be concerned, not worth being concerned mm-hmm. about. I mean, it's a huge budget. It's a small variance. That's all. It's in your defense.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I just don't think it's a big variance.
Go ahead.
Quick question on grants. This is on the reporting summary.
Mm-hmm.
Budget is 2515. Revenues is 2515. The exact same number.
Right. We always assume we're going to get all our grant revenues. Once we get the award once we know we're going to get the award letter, we assume the revenues received, even though they trickle in as we expand. And then
but wouldn't you put revenues as of 12/23/14 zero, because we haven't gotten any yet?
Oh, no, we're getting grant revenues already.
Oh, but we haven't gotten all of them.
Correct.
Right.
I just assume them. As soon as we get the award letter, I assume we've received them all, because there's no point in tracking the cash flow.
They never go back on the award letter?
Correct.
Okay. And then on revolving.
If they do, there'll be a revision, and we'll all know.
Oh, I see. On the revolving, we mm-hmm. budgeted over 3 mil, 3195. Mm-hmm. We've only received 600.
Well, 1.6 mil of that is circuit breaker.
Okay.
And I don't track the receipt of circuit breaker because we got it last year.
But we're halfway through. Shouldn't we be more than 600 right
Not
now?
Not necessarily. The foreign visa money comes in predominantly in the spring.
Okay.
And the big whack with the building rental comes in the spring. At this point, athletics, we haven't fully deposited, as of this report that we have now,
mm-hmm.
we hadn't fully deposited winter sports, and so we're only like through the fall,
right.
So there's
right.
a lot of timing on those, so I still think we're on track. It's a pretty similar pattern every year.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Well, sir. Thank you, Ms. Johnson. Superintendent's report.
Actually, I should have had Matthew Janker sing some of the talk about some of the wonderful things that have been happening in the high school, one of which he did mention was the internship program. We had a number of students, I think there were about 12, that participated in an internship this fall. A few of them are continuing all year long. And the range of on-the-ground, real-life experience has just really been quite remarkable. This week, they presented with their supervisor mentor in the on-site position, they presented what they learned, what they did in the internship. We had a couple students working again this year at MGH in one of the science labs. We had another student working with an attorney. So these are very, very significant experiences for our students. And one of the things that we are going to actively do as part of this new program of studies is to make sure that all the students in the high school, as well as their parents, know about this opportunity. Mm-hmm. And I think that with more, we've gone through the process and wanted to start out at a reasonable number of students because it does take personnel, it does take oversight and organization to be able to do a program like this well. But I think now that we're in year two, we know what to do and we are gaining more contacts all the time in terms of sites. And I would say that publicly, if anybody would like to have a high school intern, please you can contact my office or you can contact the principal's office. But I think that we very likely could double that. And we really are sort of on the forefront of many high schools in being able to offer this kind of experience to our students. So my hat's off to all the people who've been working on it because the experience of these students was very profound and they learned a lot. And I think that all of them, to a person, thought it was one of the most worthwhile things they had done in high school. And as I said, some are continuing in the spring. So that's great. And of course, we have the dual enrollment. Now we're doing more online. So there's a lot of options for our students that did not exist a couple of years ago. And that's what we want to see happen. There was another concert this week. We have a techno music and videos that go with that. There was really, I was there last night. It was very, very creative. We have a number of students doing that kind of work. The other thing I do want to let everybody know is that the entire junior class next week is going to see Selma at the Capitol.
Great.
Yay.
Paramount is giving free tickets for school groups to go.
Including school committee?
Hmm?
Including school committee members?
I didn't ask about that, Bill.
Students.
You can afford
it. No, it's schools.
School groups. So we have teachers and administrators.
Not even teachers.
Teachers are going.
Oh, they got a chaperone.
Everybody is going to it next week. So
great.
I think that is excellent.
Excellent.
I agree. I'm sorry that Dr. Chesson isn't able to be here this evening to talk a little bit more detail about this, but she has been working with her technology committee all fall in updating our technology plan. We are now at the draft stage of that plan, and we'll be giving you a copy of it very soon that you can look at. We're looking to, over the next month, to garner a lot of input on this, and the end stage being a discussion here at this table about where we're going with the plan. So we have two forums that have already been scheduled, and this will be sent out to all parents so they know this. There's February 11th, and by the way, AEF is sort of helping us with this as well, so I want to give them credit for that. There's a technology forum for the elementary level on February 11th at Bishop School. And then for the secondary level on February 25th after vacation at Odison. And times and all these reminders will be sent out. the draft technology plan will be put on the website at the time I send out the reminders, or the announcement of these forums to everyone. And then we will plan to have a discussion at this table about the information that we've gathered in creating a final plan. So we should probably have a final plan going forward, probably sometime in March. So it's been a good process. The other forum, we actually had it scheduled for next week and then ran into a scheduling problem. There is so much going on in the evenings, it's really hard to find a night. We've been looking to have a forum for parents on the Common Core and how it has affected curriculum for grades 6 through 12. That was planned and actually was planned for 28th. Turns out there was another meeting going on that was going to involve a lot of parents. We didn't want to have that conflict. So we are now looking for another night. So I will let you know as soon as we find that night, but that forum is going to happen. All incoming fifth grade parents will also be invited to it as well. It may be that it'll end up having to be after vacation now as we're starting to look at all of the events occurring in the district. So I'd wanted you to know that was happening. That is pretty much it for this evening.
Was there another meeting on the 29th?
Yes, yes, let me mention that. Thank you. I actually wrote notes to myself about it. On the 29th of January, AEF is working with the Visual Arts Department in hosting a fundraiser for the Digital Arts Program. And this is going to be at the Involution Studio, which is at 627 Mass Ave. It's on the third floor. And apparently it's quite a place. But it's scheduled from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock that evening, and you're all invited to attend, and hopefully some members of the committee will be able to be there. It's also the night that HMFH is having a panel discussion on how to do creative, innovative spaces for high school. So I'm going to try to get to both of those. But AEF is partnering with the school department in looking in raising money for technology. The technology plan, let me just say something about it. The technology plan is for our regular education programs. What there is not, it is, does not address all of the other things we might want to address, which such as STEM labs. AEF has already helped us with the math science lab, but there is more that needs to be accomplished in this area. So at any rate, there are three different fundraisers that AAF has sponsored. This is the first of three. There is also one on March 14th, which is going to be another fundraiser for technology. And then there will be our showcase, which I believe is April 13th. We'll get the date out. We're going to do another technology showcase of all that's going on in the district. So I think that that's on their website. We're going to get that information out to parents, and hopefully a couple of you will be able to make it. It's hard to reach out to all these different events which all are that are being scheduled.
Yes.
Yeah, I just have a question about the forum on Common Core. In our goals, we talked about having a forum on both Common Core and the new coming assessments, which I know.
Yes, this is plus, going to. Mm-hmm.
Is that the idea?
Yes, it's okay. Going to include that as well as if we do go to PARC, what would that mean?
Right, and what does it look like? And
right.
Will we be able to showcase, you know, have sort of computers out for people to try and see the types of questions they might be answering?
Well, I think if we were doing PARC this year, we would certainly want to do that. I'm not sure that that's in the plan for this. I think the more of the emphasis is how it has affected curriculum in English language arts and mathematics. But there will be part of the forum addressing how this is going to be tested going forward, because MCAS has changed as well. Mm-hmm. And want to make sure the parents understand that. But we're going to be doing MCAS this year, and the Board of Education will not make a final decision until the fall on PARC.
Moving on to the consent agenda, I'm going to announce that I'm going to ask for a hold of the last item. So all items listed with an asterisk are considered to be routine and will be enacted by one motion. There will be no separate discussion on these items unless a member of the committee so requests, in which event the item will be considered in its normal sequence. Approval of warrant number 15091, dated January 8th, 2015, at the amount of $459,747.74. Approval of minutes, regular school committee meeting, December 18th, 2014, and January 8th, 2015.
Hold.
Okay. So at this time, and the last one was approval of trip for Arlington High School students, class offices, community trip to Mass Association of Student Council Annual Conference, Hyannis, Mass, March 11th through the 13th, 2015. I'm asking for a hold on that one. So at this time, we will be just voting on the warrant.
And December 18th minutes.
Oh, you just the hold on the
January 8th.
The January 8th.
Yeah.
Okay. We all clear on this? All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Those opposed? We all set, Ms. Fitzgerald? We'll begin. I'll entertain a motion to accept the school committee meeting minutes for January 8th, 2015.
So
discussion?
Moved.
Oh, sorry. A motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain?
Abstain.
Abstain.
You have that?
Jeff and Judd.
Okay. With regard to the trip, I just have a couple of questions. In the document that was provided under A, it said who may go on the trip. It said four boys and four girls or eight girls. There's no chance of eight boys going? I'm just curious.
Not smart enough?
I don't know. That was presented.
I'm not going there.
Who wants to take eight boys?
You take all emails relative to that statement go directly to you. Okay.
I'm running for re-election this year.
Just a clarification.
I love boys. I'm just kidding.
The cost of $150 by approving this, are we approving the cost as well, or just the permission to go on the trip?
Permission to go on the trip.
Okay, so the cost is being borne by those that are going.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
And I want to mention, too, that students who are going to go on the trip who cannot afford the $150, that will be provided out of the student accounts.
I appreciate it. I think it's a very worthwhile trip. I'm really excited. My only confusion was that it has a similar acronym as the School Committee Association, and I was trying to figure out.
I know. I was
why
like,
a group
Mass
of kids
Association
were going.
School Committees. Yeah, yeah, where are they going?
Why would they be going? Why?
Yeah.
But aside from that, so it got me to read it. So
yeah.
With that done, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Unanimous vote. Thank you. At this time, we are moving on to the committee reports. And let's see, we have policies and procedures. Mr. Pierce.
Thank you. Nothing to report tonight, but we will be scheduling a meeting soon.
Okay. Budget, Ms. Starks.
Budget has nothing to report other than the AEF Trivia B team this year is Bill, Jeff, and me.
Uh-oh.
Yay.
One of you has to decide to be captain. It's not me.
I nominate.
I roped you.
No, I nominate Bill.
No,
Bill's
it's
the
too
chair.
Late.
No, it's the chair's job.
We need hats and we need a name.
Oh.
So I just want to remind everyone that the AEF Trivia Bee is Sunday, March 22nd at 3:00 at Town Hall. It's always a great time. Raises money for a great cause. I know that our schools probably couldn't do a lot of stuff without the funds that they raise. The budget committee will have a meeting at some point.
Okay.
When we need one, but we don't have one scheduled yet. That's
okay.
It.
Community relations, Mr. Schlickman.
We have a meeting scheduled for Thursday, January 29th at 5:30 in this very beloved room. Sounds like it's going to be a busy night for the superintendent. She's going three places at once.
Yeah,
it's on the 29th.
Yeah.
Yeah.
we doodled it. So,
might
yeah.
Might have to move it.
We might. Cindy can't do it either, so there's maybe we...
There's a move afoot to move it.
You've
got to move it.
We
move
may,
it.
Okay, so we may
doodle.
Have a...
a new
may
doodle.
Need to move it. Okay. In any case, the other thing that I'd like to bring up is on the 11th of January, Kengo Nakakoji was elected mayor of the city of Nagaokakyo. The mayor would like to restore his line item for the Arlington trip for this year. We held it in place. We had an alternative plan to have the official sponsor of the trip being the high school instead of the city itself, if the city wasn't willing to play. And we've been planning for this trip regardless of who was going to be the official agency on the Nagaokakyo side. But the city now wants to be the sponsor again, all is well with the world. So I'd like to move that the chair send a letter of congratulations to Mayor Nakakoji on his election, and cordially invite a delegation from the city of Nagaokakyo students to visit us this spring.
Is there a second?
Mr. Spiegel's raising his hand.
Second. Okay, any discussion? Yes.
I would just like to add something. We've also posted again for soliciting Arlington teachers to be an exchange teacher for next year.
Yeah.
Which this year we don't have any Arlington teachers acting as an exchange teacher. We're having an information session on Monday for any interested teachers, and the teachers in Arlington who were formerly exchange teachers will be available to talk to any interested teachers about the program.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
We're not eligible. Right?
You have to be a teacher in Arlington.
It involves working there for a year.
Yeah.
I know.
It's a great thing. Anything
else on this?
I'd just like to say this is a nice touch, and I think this will be good to send a letter like that. Yeah. Thank you, Paul.
I would ask you to help us draft it, please.
Okay, and we will have it translated.
Oh, wow. I always worry about signing things I can't read.
You can sign the English version.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Curriculum instruction and assessment accountability.
We're still gathering information. One of the people we need to speak to, the main people, has been out of town.
Okay. Facilities, Mr. Thielman?
So we met today and discussed several things. The district is going to receive a report very shortly from a company called Real and Associates for improvements to the Hardy Playground, and we hope to make the changes and improvements to the Hardy Playground this fiscal year. We discussed the refiling of our application to the statement of interest to the MSBA for the high school, and Dr. Bodie is going to send it to the full committee so that we can comment on it and give her feedback, and then the subcommittee is going to meet on March 19th to review the revised presentation to the MSBA. Any member of the committee can weigh in on what she sends out, just send comments back to Dr. Bodie. Dr. Bodie is going to put out to bid a request for, to do a space analysis and a space plan for the district, looking at various scenarios, and that's going to go to a bid in the spring, and that'll give us some sense of what our long-term needs are going to be in terms of space. And then we had a discussion, a very preliminary early discussion about options should we, or when we begin work on the Stratton School. So the Capital Planning Committee approved improvements to money that they're going to put in the capital plan, present to town meeting. If that's approved by town meeting, there'll be work done on the Stratton School that's going to necessitate moving students around the district. It's really early yet to have that conversation, so we had a very preliminary conversation about different options. Mm-hmm. Nothing definitive yet.
And it would not occur next year.
It would not occur next year.
Also? Yes.
Well, I just have a question. The space needs analysis, if we're putting it out to bid in the spring, when will we expect to get it back?
Actually, we may get it out very soon. Okay. I think we hopefully might get it back in the spring, but we want to actually probably give about 6 months on this. That may be a reasonable, but I think that whoever we end up working with, we'll negotiate when they'll be able to accomplish it. We just need to be able to start planning. It's very complicated because it's not just elementary. It's like, it's the whole district and how this is going to work as we try to accommodate our growing numbers.
So we probably wouldn't see the report until the fall.
I would say that would be a reasonable time, late summer, early fall. If it's earlier than that, we'll certainly get it to you. But we've been working on an RFP and have found out that we actually can go we don't have to go to that level. And so we're going to we're going to ratchet it back to do a bid.
Send that
out
to three companies.
Solicit three quotes.
Solicit three quotes.
Yes.
They changed the threshold for 30B for goods and services, so now anything below 35,000 can be solicited with three quotes.
That was somewhat of a, it just happened not too.
Fairly recently. Yeah.
Fairly recently, which is
to our advantage. The state did it just for us, so we can do this analysis. It's amazing.
We got something.
Just amazing.
Are we all set?
However, we do hope it comes in considerably less than that threshold.
Yeah.
In case anybody was interested.
In listening. Special study group on superintendent's evaluation. Our next meeting is next Monday, the 26th, and we'll continue working on the goals and the survey. The chair has nothing additional to report on that. Does any of the members at this time have any announcements they would like to share? And I'm only going to report on this one this time in the future. Ms. Seuss will, because she's the vice chair, joint subcommittee, human rights and commission committee. We had an organization meeting this past week to establish who the chair, the vice chair. Ms. Seuss is the vice chair. Unanimous vote to get Mr. Pierce as the secretary. No one else wanted it, so he got it. Do you want to speak to it, or I think the request for documents and things.
Yeah, yeah. We basically raised a bunch of questions. We didn't have a lot of information at our fingertips at that point. So there's real questions about what the numbers looked like, where they came from, simple questions about what the reporting mechanism, and then a little bit more about why students are being suspended and which students are being suspended. So I sent out a bunch of questions to Dr. Bode, CC'd the committee members, and I assume that people are getting comments back to you. Yeah.
Well said. Thank you. At this time, we will be entering executive session to conduct strategy session in preparation for negotiations with union and or non-union personnel, or contract negotiations with union and or non-union, in which, if held in an open meeting, may have a detrimental effect. To conduct strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation, in which, if held in an open meeting, may have a detrimental effect. Collective bargaining may also be conducted. We will only adjourn only to, excuse me, we will leave executive session only to adjourn the regular school committee meeting. Motion to enter executive session.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call vote.
Yes.
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 Aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Five yeses, two ayes. It's approved.